Welcome to PressTV's in-depth look at the occurrences in Yemen. Let's give a quick overview. After over 3 months of anti-regime demonstrations, Yemen appears to have slid into an all-out fight for power, with pitched battles between government forces and armed tribesmen who have descended to the capital, Sana'a. The presidential palace of President Abdullah Saleh has reportedly come under attack. Now, at first it was reported that President Saleh had died in this incident, but later it became clear that he had sustained injuries along with the parliament speaker. Not so lucky was the country's prime minister, reported to be in critical condition. Also in the incident, four presidential guards were killed. We could go on with the number killed in the past 10 days, 150, which is showing how much the situation is in crisis mode in Yemen and how it has escalated. Let's figure out what is going on and what these recent developments actually mean. We have political analyst Mohsen Saleh, who joins us from Beirut. Mohsen Saleh, thanks for joining us. Of course, I'd like to begin with the incidents at the presidential palace. Let's break down what has happened. The reports say shells were fired onto the palace. That's one side of the story. The other side of the story being that there was a violent confrontation that took place. If these two are true, what does it mean? Can you break this down for us in terms of what it means in relation to whether there's been defections and, of course, if that is the case inside the palace, what that signifies?
Well, it seems that the situation in Yemen is dramatically changing in Yemen, in Sana'a, especially after the massacres yesterday and before yesterday in Sana'a and Taiz, and after the shelling of the regime of the tribesmen and tribes, chief tribes in the in some places in Taiz, also in other places in the south. This peak of the situation, I guess, will change the whole situation dramatically in Yemen. And the deadlines are broken in this situation. And I guess there is no way of implementing any kind of initiatives, whether
right.
the
Mohsen
Gulf
Saleh,
initiative
before you continue,
or the American initiative.
I'm sorry, Mohsen Saleh. Yeah. I'd like, before you continue, and those are very great points that you're introducing here, but I'd like to find out what has happened in the presidential palace, because I believe, and of course you're more of a analytical viewpoint is more valuable to us, but what has occurred in the palace is of great significance, given that it's happened on those premises and in the manner that it has. If you can break that down for us, please, so we can get an idea of what has indeed happened there.
Well, of course, the situation in Yemen now, after the Arab initiative or the Gulf initiative reached its peak and did not reach any point, they have to do something. Of course, probably the Saudis have some defectors and they try to kill or to do something in the palace. Or the tribesmen, they really try to kill Ali Abdullah Saleh, because Abdullah Saleh is now the kind of the ring that is complicating the situation. And by killing Abdullah Saleh or wounding some of his entourage, the PM or some of his military leaders in this cabinet, they will break the circle and break the situation into a new way of dealing with it. That's my analysis of the situation. Otherwise, the massacres and the killing is going on. There would be no initiative to succeed in this manner unless they do something dramatic. And this dramatic had happened today. And by killing or trying to kill Ali Abdullah Saleh, the fear will go into the heart of the regime. And that will change the psychological and the practical on the ground. Whether in the palace or in the army, that will encourage the army to divide or to separate itself from the regime. I guess a new situation is witnessing now. We are witnessing now a new situation. Tomorrow will be unlike today. And we will see the Yemenis will be encouraging more to go into the streets in order to topple the regime. But we have another things to say about the American role and the Saudi role in Yemen. What will they do in this situation? Will they support the regime, the same regime, or will they go to Ali al-Ahmar or to the Yemenis or make a kind of compromise or conference for these tribes in order to come to terms, in order to solve the situation in Yemen?
Before you continue, Saleh, you made some very good points there, which I'd like to get more of, and of course, an added view. Raza Kazim from the Islamic Human Rights Commission joins us from London. Raza Kazim, just talking to Mohsen Saleh, made a great point about what is going on. First of all, the landscape has changed. The incident today obviously indicates that. Let's figure out what President Saleh, at least try to figure out what he is thinking, because based on what Mohsen Saleh said, he's basically creating new facts on the ground, if that's a correct conclusion that I drew upon you, Mohsen Saleh. My question to you is, Raza Kazim, these new facts on the ground, is it because he wants to avoid this GCC initiative, or is he hoping to degrade maybe the main opposition, which is said to be the Al-Ahmar family, as Mohsen Saleh just said, and create such bloodshed and chaos that everybody perhaps then might be drawn into agreeing to him to stay on? What is your viewpoint on the maneuvering of the president?
One of the things that this person is actually drawing strength from is the backing that he has managed to keep from the Americans. Remember that he's someone who's classified as a good friend, classic situation. So although there are these initiatives going on, he has felt so much in control because of the backing that he has received that he somehow feels that he will be immune from some of these things. So I think in it's beyond belief that even those people that would be classified as being sympathetic to him and his situation have suggested certain things, and yet he is reneged on what was going to happen. So I think in terms of his position, he's feeling that this bloodshed could actually potentially go on, and he will actually be able to maintain his position as is. However, the situation is clearly changing and evolving, and the Americans in the meantime are trying to make sure that there is going to be some kind of manipulation of both the people who are basically in power and the opposition, so that whatever side comes in, there is enough time for them to build an opposition which they would actually be comfortable with.
Can I jump in here and ask you something? Is the United States, or we could even put Saudi Arabia together because they will appear to be on the same page, are they in reactionary mode when it comes to President Saleh?
I think that they've been working on this for quite some time. The Saudis have been involved in Yemen for quite some time.
But in terms of the recent events, in terms of what is going on recently, as we have seen in the past couple of weeks, or maybe even the past month, especially with that GCC deal led by Saudi Arabia, backed by the U.S.
Saudi has been in a reactionary mode up to a point because they don't know what's happening on the street. They can't control the street. That's their problem. What they are trying to do is manipulate the tribal leaders. They're trying to make sure that certain things actually happen in certain ways. And for that, they're not being reactionary. They're being proactive. Where they have to react is when something happens out on the street, when the scale of the killing that goes on increases to a point where it's going to be problematic for anyone to be able to hang on. And I think, so the idea that Saudi Arabia is being reactionary, it's only where it has to be. There's a lot of manipulation of the tribal leaders that is going on behind the scenes by Saudi Arabia. It has been documented, and it is something that is continuing.
Okay, let me bring in Mohsen Saleh. Mohsen Saleh, tell us more about the alignments that Saudi Arabia is making based on what Raza Kazim just said with the tribal leaders. Who are they trying to align themselves with? We know that at the center of the Al-Ahmar family is that Yemeni billionaire Hamid Al-Ahmar. He wants the presidency for himself. Is that one character that the Saudis are aligning themselves with? Or if you can tell us who else it may be.
Well, the Saudis, you know that they were behind Ali al-Ahmar, and they paid him money, and they tried to mediate between Ali Abdullah Saleh and Ali al-Ahmar in order to keep a peaceful transition in the regime. Now we have another players in Yemen. We have Al-Qaeda, We have the Sa'da and Al-Houthiyin, and we have Hashid, we have the Yemenis, the southern movement, and we have another players also. The tribal emotions and feelings now are moving towards a new participation in the political arena. We will see many, many complications and new complications in the Yemeni situation. The United States and the Saudi Arabia will play on this now in order to reshape the political situation in Yemen. And they won't be convinced that Ali Abdullah Saleh or Ali Al-Ahmar stay in power.
Okay, because whoever Saleh, all the factions that you just mentioned, do you really, yeah. I mean, it would be very hard to believe that the United States actually has control of all these different factors which you just mentioned, which make up the
I'm
landscape.
I'm not saying all of them, they are under the American umbrella or the Saudi umbrella, because the Houthis are not, and the Qaeda is not also. But we have another players, as I said, but the United States will try to marginalize most of these parties in order to bring about a new situation that Ali Al-Ahmar would be probably the principal of them. But I guess we will see instability in Yemen in order to reshape the political scene in Yemen. They won't be convinced that to see just this situation, that to kill Ali Abdullah Saleh or to wound him or to kill some of his entourage or his family, that's not enough for them. For them, that they want the Yemenis to get fatigue in order to say to the United States and the Saudis, come and probably help us in order to get rid of the situation, save us of the situation, because the Yemenis have been going on for in this situation for a long time, and the United States, from its interest to probably, I should say, Somalize Yemen for a certain period in order to see a new situation capable, or give them a reason to go into that.
Well,
because
I don't think one of the things that the United States was counting on is the fact that U.S. trained counterterrorism forces have been used in Yemen against the other armed forces. This is special forces under the command of Saleh's son. So, Raza Kazim, break this down for me. You have these forces trained by the U.S. under Saleh's son, under the command of Saleh's son, of which some are defecting, and then you have General Al-Ahmar. If you remember back in March, he was the one that was a senior military leader who defected. And curiously, he hasn't really come into the forefront recently. How is this going to pan out, these different scenarios, of which I assume is not something that the United States anticipated, especially these U.S.-trained counterterrorism forces, of which some have defected?
This is precisely the problem that that the United States is actually facing, that despite the many attempts, that whereas Yemen is strategically very important to them, and it's also quite important for Saudi Arabia, and therefore for all of these things that they did not expect to happen, that you have outlined, that are happening, are causing the whole calculations to change. And these kind of things are causing them problems. That's why they have wanted to keep this person on, although they have been quite happy, for example, in Egypt, to a certain extent they were caught unawares, that Mubarak went, and they were happy to have something else come in its place, which they were still relatively comfortable with. Here, they haven't got that comfort zone, their comfort blanket, where they can say, okay, if that person goes, it doesn't matter, our interests will still be protected, whatever you call interest. That kind of thing will actually still be happening. And I think that's why these problems are existing, that this person is still there and is continuing to hang on, because the Americans do not have an alternative, a viable alternative that they feel that they can actually trust. And, I think there might well be discussions going on between the Saudis and Americans as to what the way forward is going to be, because things aren't panning out the way the plans had been laid out for it to happen.
And, of course, we want to put this into perspective. If we want to look at the situation, Mohsen Saleh, and by that I mean we look at all these complications in Yemen, and this is, the Yemeni people. What about them? Where does it leave them? They just came out in protest. They just wanted a better financial situation for themselves economically. So where does that leave them?
I guess that is the issue. That's the core issue of in Yemen. Well, first I should give one remark about my colleagues saying that the Americans and the Saudis were happy with the toppling of Hosni Mubarak, and that's not true. They tried to help him for a long time, but they could not. The Egyptians imposed on the Americans and the Saudis to change their mind. They did not change their mind from Hosni Mubarak till now, probably. That's why I try to ease the complications of his imprisonment and his trial. But now in Yemen, now if the Yemenis, really, the opposition parties, they come together and unite against the Americans' intervention and the Saudi intervention, I guess they will benefit, and then they will respond positively to the situation and the demands of the Yemenis. Because really, the Yemenis are tired from the south and north, from this tribe and that tribe, from this despotism or that, from Ali Abdullah Saleh and from the military attacks against them and imprisonment, corruption, poverty, all these things. And they are tired. The Yemenis want to see real transition into a new situation against the Saudi intervention, this backward regime, and the American intervention in a strategic place and their interest. And I guess the Saudis imposed on Yemenis not to excavate for oil and try to bribe them in order to stay in a situation like
situation. We're running out of time real quick. Raza Kazim, so how can that be stopped? We had recently the youth group in a warning. We call on the U.S., the EU, the permanent U.S. Security Council members to stop meddling against the will of the Yemeni people to ensure freedom and democracy. So how can this be stopped in terms of the influence and the steering and the molding that the U.S. and Saudi Arabia perhaps are playing in the fate of the Yemenis?
The people, Yemeni people, will need to keep on struggling. This isn't going to go away by simply a call for that. I think there's also an issue that there needs to be much greater recognition about the people people in the West to recognize the extent to which Western governments are actually meddling in the affairs of the Yemeni people, since we're focused on this in particular at the moment. And we need to make sure that this meddling is actually counterproductive for the interests of the people of the Western countries. Forget about the governments, because they have their own agenda of what they actually want to try and do. And I think unless that awareness is actually raised, that this is something that should not be happening, the countries should focus in their energy and on the financial crisis that is affecting the UK, that is affecting the US and other places, rather than spending money on meddling in these places, then they'll be far, far better off. And I think there is a whole list of things that can be talked about in that regard. Bottom line is that they must stop meddling, and that until that awareness is raised, that is not going to happen.
Well, we saw what happened when the Egyptian President Hosni Mubarak was toppled. Prime Minister David Cameron went in there, and he was pitching with a bunch of arms manufacturers for sales, not to mention, of course, money that's been thrown about by the U.S. president, which all brings back to whether this interference or meddling is going to stop and what it's going to take. Mohsen Saleh, I mean, at the end, if we want to look at the President Saleh himself, what is his game plan when he's looking at this scenario? Is his alignment a U.S.-backed one, a Saudi-backed one, or a combination of both?
Well, of course, there is a common interest between the Saudis and the Americans. Of course, for example, the Americans ordered the Saudis to go and intervene militarily in Bahrain in order to put down the revolution. And they might move. Also, they moved towards Yemen when the Houthis really did some benefit or did some victories against Ali Abdullah Saleh, and really they were afraid. And this scary situation in the Saudis and the American interest will come together in order to create a new situation in Yemen. But I guess the Yemenis are smart enough in order to create their own situation and not to let the Saudis. And I guess one of the problems of the Saudi initiative that the Yemenis do not like the Saudis. And now they started not to like, and from long ago, they not like the American intervention. And I guess this transitional situation is really good for the Yemenis to get rid of despotism and dictatorship of Ali Abdullah Saleh and to create a new psychological and cultural situation for a new regime in Yemen.
Okay, thank you very much. Mohsen Saleh from Beirut, political analyst. Thank you so much for your statements.